Harper Audio presents A New Model: What Confidence, Beauty, and Power Really Look Like by Ashley Graham with Rebecca Paley. Read by Ashley Graham and Almarie Guerra. This is Ashley Graham. Hi there! Thank you for listening to this audiobook. Before we launch into chapter one and I let a professional narrator read you the rest of this book, I want to tell you a little bit about myself and how I've become successful as a model. Introduction: My Cellulite Revolution. I'm in three places at once right now, doing half a dozen different things. Sitting in a director's chair, I'm getting my hair and makeup done, and my picture taken by a dozen event photographers at the same time. I'm also taking over Harper's Bazaar's Snapchat and Elle Canada's Instagram, so my phone is on fire. In about 60 seconds, I'm going to be on the move, making sure that my boobs are in the right place and my bodysuit doesn't accidentally open. Because while I'm obviously not ashamed of the female form, we don't need a crotch shot on the runway during my show. Oh, and I'm keeping a smile on my face the whole time. Because if you're awful to someone just once, that means you're awful for the rest of your life. It might be forgivable if I snapped, since I am very nervous. So nervous I woke up this morning and had to run to the toilet. The show for this year's New York Fashion Week is featuring my lingerie collection for Editionnel, with my name all over it. Last year when we did the show, the response was huge. The image of me coming down the runway in lacy panties, bra, and heels broke the internet. Khloe Kardashian reposted it, and for that week, I was one of the most influential images along with Pope Francis and President Obama. That was beyond. Okay, but that was last year, and in fashion, a year is forever. The big question looming over me is, will I be able to do it again? I feel a lot of pressure to have everyone and everything look as amazing as last year. I want to make as big an impact as last year, if not bigger. Not just because I'm a model and this is my career, but because showing gorgeous, curvy women walk down the runway in sexy lingerie is part of my bigger mission in my industry and in my life. To prove that every body is different and beautiful. This is the generation of body diversity. We are sick of being told by society, by the fashion industry, by Hollywood, that we are too thin, too fat, too flabby, too tall, too small. Being a woman in the United States now almost definitely means hating at least a part of your body, if not all of it. As a woman unafraid of celebrating my thick thighs in public, I've made it my goal to help others embrace, even love themselves, stretch marks and all. My evolution into an activist for self-love was a gradual process. I trace the very beginnings of it to the start of my career, when I was surprised at how insecure most models acted. Big or small, it didn't matter. I noticed that so many of these women complained about their cellulite popping out or their arms looking big. It was honestly no different than when the tiny popular cheerleaders at my high school complained, "I'm so fat today." Although it's so commonplace for women to put themselves down, it's also really uncomfortable to be around. If you hear it enough, you start to believe the things that person is telling herself and even apply it to yourself. But when we models put down our physical appearance, it's especially sad because we are being paid to look good. If you are cast in a shoot, the theory is that you are the most beautiful woman for this job. So why would you feel any other way about yourself? I've seen it over and over on set, and it's always ugly to watch. I wanted to be appealing, the girl you can trust and really talk to. So I vowed to myself early on that I would not belittle myself, no matter what anyone else said to me or how I felt about myself privately. I don't know if it's the reason for my career's success. I'm sure it's a part of it. But I've achieved more than anyone ever thought possible for a plus-size model. I have appeared on many magazine covers, like the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue, despite being told I'd never be a cover girl, landed campaigns for major retailers like Levi's and Sephora, and even walked in a fashion show for H&M in Paris. All of that has helped me push against the status quo for beauty within the fashion industry. Beyond my career, though, I began to realize that when I was positive about myself, it made others feel better about themselves. I started to get a sense of this effect on set in little reactions from other models, makeup or hairstylists, managers, and photographers. Repeatedly, people told me not only how confident they could see I was, but also that it was contagious. I loved that idea so much that it became a way of life for me. My mother, assistant, glam squad, and anyone else I spend a lot of time with have to talk positively about themselves, because if they don't, I check them quickly. My manager, my agent, my assistant, my publicist, and my book publisher are all curvy women. Does that make me biased? Or does that just mean we are really the majority? The advent of social media allowed me to bring this message to a much bigger audience than those who knew me from catalogs and magazines. What began as something I did to help myself and the women in my life was suddenly transformed into a way of helping women everywhere. Just like I told Cosmo when they put me on their cover, my cellulite is changing someone's life out there. I've got to be honest, though. Miss Body Positivity didn't wake up the morning of my fashion show feeling so, well, positive. I felt really mad at myself because the night before I had gone out to the restaurant Tao and ordered the lobster fried rice. I felt like I had to. It was my best friend's birthday, but lobster fried rice. The night before a lingerie show? Really? That was pushing it, even for me. But damn, it was so good. Anyway, I couldn't undo what I'd done. And I couldn't go to the gym that morning. So I just did a sprint up a big hill near my house, showered, and prayed. I thanked God for this opportunity and reminded myself that it's not only about me. If I indulged in a bad day by having a pity party about what I ate and was feeling bad enough about myself that it showed when I walked down the runway, I'd be letting down all those women whose lives I said I wanted to change. It's irrational to think that one slip up the night before could have changed my body in any meaningful way. The problem was in my mind more than anywhere else, and I never want food to take over my world in this way. So instead of putting on the yoga pants and cozying up on the couch like I might have wanted to, I threw on a tight opening ceremony knit dress that wasn't just smoking hot. It also wouldn't make any lines or indentations on my body that could be seen later on the runway. This is the kind of thing you have to think about when you're a model and have some meat on your bones. Clothes leaving marks. I put an embellished Sonia Rykiel jean jacket over that, and I thought to myself, I look good. Now I feel good. If my affirmations didn't really make me feel better, this crowd at my fashion show does. There are some new girls here and a lot of really good friends, like Georgia Pratt, Marquita Pring, Precious Lee, and Tara Lynn. These are some of the top plus-size models in the industry, and if you haven't heard of them already, you need to learn their names. We all have the same message. No matter what your size, you are beautiful. We have just been given different opportunities to share it. We will make the shift in fashion that needs to happen when many voices are heard. One name does not change an industry. It can make a dent, but to continue the change, we need more women speaking their minds and presenting their diversity. It's empowering to know that this group of high-profile women, my people, are here to support me by being in the show. All the models are having beachy waves put in their hair and red liner put around their eyes, which I'm starting to have second thoughts about. The head makeup artist described red as strong, feminine, and unexpected. It's definitely in style this season, which makes it unexpected for my runway, because plus-size models always get the same kind of makeup, safe. We're always made to look pretty and commercial pretty. There's a saying that plus-size models are unicorns. There's much more variation in terms of acceptable looks when it comes to straight-size models, including such genres as dolls, androgynous, aliens, and bombshells. But as long as, for the most part, they conform to the right measurements, anywhere from 5'9 to 6'1 and a size 2, 4, or 6, they will find work. Plus-size models need to have an hourglass figure, a flat stomach, a sweet but skinny face, and up until 5 years ago, long hair. I remember the first time a plus-size model got a pixie cut, and it sent shockwaves through the industry because no one was ready for it. In terms of measurements, you have to be at least 5'9", but being over 6 feet tall is a big no-no. And you have to fit into plus-size sample sizes, which are 12, 14, and 16. Smaller models, who are more size 10, have custom bodysuits with padding that fills them out in the breasts, butt, and hips. Kind of a reverse Spanx that they have to carry with them to all their jobs like hair extensions. You also hardly ever see plus-size models in high-end fashion magazines, but I'm pushing that envelope too. They don't give the curvy girls the weird, interesting stuff. That's why I initially loved that the makeup team for this show were going in a different, edgier direction. But as the head makeup artist applies the red liner around my eyes, I start to look as if I have a wicked case of pink eye. Not a good look for the runway. I'm committed to the idea that curvy girls can push fashion. We're already doing it. Earlier that week, I went to Christian Siriano's runway show, where he featured 5 plus-size models. Siriano, a Project Runway alum, also does a line for plus-size retailer Lane Bryant, but this show was for his personal line. I love that he's willing to take this stand where many of his peers haven't. None of this is easy, though. Not even women as gorgeous as the models surrounding me backstage at my lingerie show are immune to feelings of insecurity and even self-hatred. One of the girls, models often affectionately call each other girls, told me point blank that if she had to wear a bra and panty set, she wasn't walking. It wasn't a diva moment. "I don't want my stomach jiggling as I go down the runway," she said. "And this is a goddess." So I gave her a bodysuit to wear. There's so much anxiety around weight for all women. While I've had moments where I felt really fat because I've failed to hit the gym for months or I've eaten pasta and pizza 5 nights in a row, for the most part, I don't worry about the number on the scale. Don't get me wrong, I have those days where I think I'm the ugliest person alive, but it always stems from a professional failure, like not being able to land the beauty shot a photographer wanted. It's funny that the thing I'm known for, my size, is not something I'm naturally focused on. It's not that I'm more evolved. I think I'm just missing a certain self-conscious gene. For instance, I have no problem standing around naked right now in front of dozens of hair and makeup people, production assistants, and security guards. That's one of the things Carrie, the show stylist, loves about me. No shrinking violet himself, Carrie is racing around backstage in a mesh tank top that shows full nip, thick gold chains, big hoop earrings, and mirrored sunglasses with gold monkeys sitting atop the frames. "Let's keep it PG," he says, putting a trench coat on a model whose panties show her entire backside. Carrie and I work together a lot, and he knows that when we're on set, I pretty much have an open door or open robe policy. Whereas a lot of models are extremely shy about being naked in front of others, I couldn't care less. In fact, I can't stand changing tents. These are tents the size of a dressing room stall at a department store that pop up and down for privacy when a model is changing on an outdoor set. My attitude is, we're here to work, so let's just get it done. I'm not going to take 10 minutes to walk over to some change tent when time on a job is precious. Unless they're a paparazzi, then I have to change in one. Carrie thinks that's me being body confident, as he calls it. He describes me as very free and says the fact that I'm happy with who I am is the best way for me to relay my message of positivity to others. But the truth is, I'm not thinking about it at all when I strip down in front of tons of people. I just want to do my job. My whole childhood, I ran around half naked. So did my little sisters, Madison and Abigail. As the oldest and bossiest, I might have exerted some influence over them. Whatever the reason, the three of us never had much on, even when we became teenagers. We thought it was totally normal to hang around the house in bras and panties. This is particularly ironic since my mom was never naked. I didn't see my mom's breasts until 3 years ago.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.